Good morning, dear delegates, participants, and all other viewers watching this video of this 1 week long national level FDP organized by Government First Grade College and PG Study Center, Bapuji Nagara, Shimoga. Myself, Dr. Harish V. I believe that you have already participated or watched many online courses of this nature where speakers have addressed the challenges of higher education during this COVID-19 pandemic from different points of view, from policy makers to universities and administrators. From different points of view they have spoken already. Today in this talk, I wish to present some of the general challenges faced from a teacher's point of view. Then in particular, the challenges of a physics teacher. Further, what are the resources available for a physics teacher for teaching both theory as well as practical classes. First, let me take up with what are the challenges in online teaching. And you already have the experience that decisions taken by the governments were so rapid that teachers had very less time, maybe of the order of a day or a week, notice to pack up their belongings and protect and settle themselves from this pandemic. In addition, they had to begin figuring out the methods or systems to keep the students engaged in learning at home. We know that this lockdown period is very stressful. Teachers somehow admitted or adapted to this initial transition. Many felt it as a bit of relief because this lockdown period is something like an unwanted vacation by surprise. Some teachers may even felt it like might be a much needed short break from routine work. But this sweet feeling was for a very short period. It was not for a long period. They no longer had to wait for the other shoe to wear. It means whatever the routine conventional teaching job they were doing, they had to shift into another way of working nature. They had to wear a new shoe, new job, online teaching. The transition to working from home or online has not merely involved a location shift for teachers, but it is completely a different way of working. Many teachers are feeling lost totally, especially without the face-to-face interactions with the students that keep them passionate about the job. Unless teachers accept and understand the situation, they may lose interest in teaching itself. It's a huge challenge to teach online. All of a sudden, because teachers are not used to this kind of teaching, sitting all the day in front of the computers, preparing and delivering the required material to students with limited access to their conventional working facilities like library, laboratories, other departments, other teachers, maybe personal materials what they were using earlier for preparation of the teaching, okay? So, their dependence has shifted to internet resources now. Teachers need time to learn and understand these virtual sources. Then only they can do better, they can deliver better and effectively to the students. In many professional schools or colleges, online teaching means showing some slideshows. Slideshows have become so pervasive that a meeting or a training or a class rarely goes without their presence. Many of us have observed many teachers reading directly from the slides while teaching on the other side, students simply looked on the slides without any discussion or questions. Dependence on slides not only suffocates the class, but it may also remove student voices and critical thinking processes from the lesson. I'm not saying that we should ban the slides, but both students and teachers may be benefited by reducing the number of slides and focusing on other forms of instruction. On the other hand, both students and teachers have to take care of new health challenges also arising out of engaging with computers, tablets or mobiles for prolonged hours, such as tennis elbow. It's a problem, health problem that arises for continuous usage of computers, and reading difficulties may arise because of stress, headache, it may lead to headache, and other health problems may arise. So because to resolve these kind of health issues, doctors always suggest a rule. It's called a 20-20-20 rule. I repeat, 20-20-20 rule to reduce eye strain and also stress. 20-20-20 rule means every 20 minutes, look at something that is 20 feet away and you must look at it for at least 20 seconds. It means you should take a break for every 20 minutes, look at something that is 20 feet away and you should observe that object for at least 20 seconds. That is 20-20-20 rule. So then only we can go healthy with this kind of situation without any health issues. And also you must take care of the contrast and brightness of the screens what we are using. The screen should not be brighter than the room. Because we are living in a time of unprecedented stress, both students and teachers make sure to find time to take care of themselves and prioritize what is essential to not just learning and other type of work, because you are already taken away from your routine way of life. Earlier, how you are leading your life from morning to evening till going to the bed. So some of the things have been removed from that list, actually timetable. So now you have to consider those things also, and you have to adjust your timetable in such a way that all the physical activities, mental activities comes into your daily activity. Plan timings inside online remote learning schedule for breaks, meals, exercise and sleeping also, just as you would do lesson planning, setting reminders or alarms on your phone and handwriting out a daily to-do list may help keep you on track. These are just some of the general challenges in my point of view for online teaching. So now let me come to what are the challenges in teaching physics, because I'm a student of physics and also I'm teaching physics for my students. So what kind of challenges a physics teacher may face during this kind of situation when we have to shift from conventional teaching to online teaching? Teaching physics is not a joy walk in the park. We already know that. Most of the students as well as teachers have a common opinion that physics is quite tough subject, it is difficult to understand and blah blah blah, those kind of things, that kind of opinions are there. With all the overwhelming formulas, strange symbols, abstract concepts, it takes a lot of effort for teachers and also to students to understand the knowledge about the physics actually. The important problem of education in physics is formation of natural science type of thinking. Most of the students lack this kind of thinking actually, to train their acquaintance with the ways and structure of the physical world around. They should be able to appreciate how the world around us works actually, what are the physical processes are happening there, what kind of physics is involved over there. All that kind of appreciation is very essential when we start learning physics. Most of the students have the belief that fundamental laws of physics have secondary relevance to their professions, because they think that they are not going to become anyway physicists. That it should go out of their mind first. And they believe that physical laws are applicable only in ideal or laboratory conditions only. They may be involved in real life examples once we go outside the home or outside the classroom, and the practical formulas are the only relevant ones. So that kind of opinions should go away first. Students have this kind of belief because they have roots in their previous education, right from the primary education itself. Asking students about their experience from teaching physics, most of them remember or recall physical concepts only by memorizing some definitions, memorizing some equations, calculating some examples, that's all. But everything far away from real life actually. But in this age of new technology, teachers are given the opportunity to make teaching a little bit more easier as well as a lot more fun. So now let us move on to the other aspects of our new methods or our technology support, what we can make use of for making online teaching easier and as well as fun actually. So now let us see some of the online learning resources. First I will focus on the general resources, and then I will move on to the resources which are more relevant to the physics teaching. And some of the sources what we can see are Google or any other search engines. They can be used as teaching tools: Wikipedia, InfliptNet, and DOAJ, it means Directory of Open Access Journals. And then we have repositories for digital thesis and dissertations. And we have books depositories, like PDF drive. And then we have a variety of online educational resources and MOOCs, and those courses you can have it from most of the Western universities. And Indian context, we can have NMAICT projects like Sakshat. It was a old one, now it has become Swayam portal. From there also we can attend or conduct many OERs and MOOCs courses from there. I hope everyone is familiar with this page, that is a Google page. And Google is a source of lot of information as well as lot of tools also. And what you have to do is you just need to register in and open a Google account, and you have to sign in, register, and one account is enough to access all the resources what the Google is providing for everyone. And let us see what kind of apps it has got. So it has more than 60 different apps that are useful for almost all the work what we do. It is from our email, using email, as well as a browser for searching information on internet, as well as a Google Drive for storing some of the important files what we have. And then Google Documents is there, where you can create some documents, you can create some Google Forms, and you can create slides over there. Google Slides is there, that can be used for sharing slides, just equivalent to your PowerPoint presentation. We have Google Slides also. And then we have Google Classroom app is there. You can create a Google Classroom, and you can add students into that. You can conduct classes as we do in our regular classrooms. It is exactly similar to that. You can teach them online. For teaching them online, we have Google Meet app is there. Using that, you can teach them. And after that, you can give assignments, you can give quizzes, tests, assessment tests, and even examination also. And it will reduce our effort also. And we have YouTube. It's a large collection of variety of videos, and a careful selection of appropriate videos from YouTube. We can use them as a support for our online teaching. Like that, variety of apps are there. So you are needed only to explore those things. And another is Wikipedia. So it is a very good reference. We can say large amount of information collected from different people around the globe into a single book, I can say. Okay, it's a free encyclopedia, we can call. So it is available in variety of languages, and probably we need only English in this part. So you can search anything and everything. So someone has already added some information about what you are searching for. So almost it has got more than a billion pages of information in this. So it is a very good source of information. But only drawback of this Wikipedia is, whatever the information is available, it is not verified. It is not verified. So only thing is, you have to confirm whatever the information is available is correct, and then you can use it. Because anybody can add information into this. And from Indian context, so our UGC has a project of InfliptNet under this NLIST, National Library and Information Services infrastructure for scholarly context. So that is NLIST page is there. So I believe almost all your libraries have registered for this, and it will charge only a nominal charge fee for the institutional membership, around 5,000 to 6,000 rupees per year. But it is a huge collection of research papers, books and much more. So we can make use of them and we can ask the students to go there and refer whatever the information is available. And another web page is Directory of Open Access Journals, where we get most of the free journals, and they are meant for only free access. And it has got a very good collection of journals there. Thousands of journals have been added. Nearly 11,000 journals are there. It has got more than 282 million articles are there. So you may find what the information you are required for your supporting students. And another important website is NDLTD. It's a networked digital library for thesis and dissertation. So it is actually having more than 100 universities across the world who have been networked, and they have added all their theses and dissertations published in their universities. They converted them into digital form and they have added here. More than a million theses are available. So if you give a search for a single area of subject, so you will get tens of thousands of theses and dissertations published in that particular area. So it is a very good source of theses and dissertations. And for those people who are actually involved in research, so you can search here and you will find very good information which is already published. So the page somewhat looks like this. It has got a search tab. You can search it there. Or you can go by subject wise also, content you can open and you can search as per your subject area. You can browse it there. And another important website that is available is PDF Drive. So it is meant for getting books in the PDF form. And I don't know whether it is legal or not, because most of the copyrighted books have been uploaded here. But still you get a large amount of books here. So you can see that 48 million books are available here. 48 million books means it is very huge number. And you will get most of the Western edition books. Indian edition books are very limited in this web page. And OERs and MOOCs, as I mentioned, you can join them in most of the Western university sites as well as the SWAYAM portal in Indian level. So most of the courses are free to join. They provide learning material in the form of either videos or notes or PPTs, and they encourage us to read some of the books also. And they are free to join. You know, for the sake of knowledge, you can join and learn things there. But if you need a certification, then they charge very nominal fees. And teachers who are doing their refresher courses, so they have to join for ARPIT courses. They are actually considered as refresher courses, and there is no fee for the certification. They give assignments, they conduct exams, so that when we complete all those requirements, so they give certification, they give e-certification for the course what we attend. So this is the SWAYAM portal. It looks somewhat like this. And you can read about SWAYAM, for what purpose this SWAYAM portal was designed. Earlier it was in the form of Sakshar, and Sakshar portal was actually designed only for students, not for the teachers. Only teachers have to teach there, help the students to learn. But this is the portal where teachers can also learn, students can also learn. So we have a very large collection of courses available here, online courses. Many universities as well as institutes like Indian Institute of Science or IITs have designed courses, and they have added large number of courses here. And there will be two schedules in a year, most probably in the month of June or July. One schedule will begin and another schedule may start from December or January, and you have to continuously look in this web page for the start of the courses, and you can choose and you can join some of the courses. The course page will look somewhat like this, like Managerial Economics, Introduction to Operations Management, like that. There is a huge collection of courses will be there here. And now I am coming to the online resources for a physics teacher. Whatever I discussed so far, they are general. All subject teachers and students can go there and find the information what they require, and they can use those information for dispensing the online content. Now, resources for online physics. We have one web page that's called Hyperphysics. Hyperphysics is actually a page, or I can say it's a interactive ebook. It is an interactive ebook that has been designed by Georgia State University of USA. That is, you can see GSU here, Georgia State University. And it is a textbook actually, it is an interactive textbook, put it in a web page. And even you can download it, keep a soft copy in your systems, either laptop or desktop or even mobile. And you can use it offline also, you don't require internet every time for this Hyperphysics. And in addition to Hyperphysics, they have designed Hyperchemistry also, Hyperbiology also, and most of the science subject areas have been converted into this kind of ebook format by Georgia State University. So I am talking only about Hyperphysics, and it has got all the areas like electricity and magnetism, light and vision, sound and hearing, relativity, astrophysics, quantum mechanics, and nuclear physics, condensed matter physics, heat and thermodynamics, and then mechanics like that. Almost all the areas of physics it covers. And you must remember, this is not for advanced learning. This is only for fundamental physics understanding. And it has got a simple user interface. You can click on the type whatever you require. So whenever you are in the some other page, if you click index, it will come back to this page. And I'll just show you one of the page, say light and vision. If we click, so it will enter into light and vision page. And you can see that light and vision has sub concepts like this, sub chapters are available. You can click on any of those concepts and you can understand. There you will have the pictures, explanations, derivations, as well as some interactive pages have been designed. You can submit some values over there and it will calculate. It will show some calculated values also. That kind of options are also available in this one. It's a very useful page for most of the UG students as well as PUC students. It's quite useful for them. Next, another one is Physics Classroom. This is another page available where this is meant for learning fundamental physics only, not for higher advanced level physics. And you can see that physics levels have been classified as first grade, second grade, third, fourth, up to 8th grade, like that they have been designed. And there is a set of content available is also shown on the left side. You can see that physics tutorial, it means it will tell about the physics and classes about that. And then physics interactive means interactive pages are also there. You can play around with those interactives. Concept builders are there. Video tutorials have been added. Shockwave studios are also there, where you can see some simple videos over there. Multimedia studios means longer videos you can see there, like that. Most of the supporting material for physics teaching have been put into this web page, that is Physics Classroom. So you can register here for free. Earlier it was using a Google account itself as the account required for joining this. Now they have stopped it, so you have to register directly and you can join, and you can make use of the material available here. After this, we will move on to some other apps that are available for teaching physics. So my first one is I'm calling Simple Physics. It's an app actually that is freely available. You can download it to your either laptop or mobiles and you can play around. So in the tutorial section, it will teach you how to use this and how to install and all those things. And then there are several play or games you can play, and those games actually require your attention. And you have to apply some physics there, then you can play around with that. If you violate any of the physics laws, so it will show whatever you have done is wrong. So you can construct some structures like building bridges, ferries, okay, and then they are very strong enough, whether they can withstand the external forces. So you have to design such that. And you can play around with that kind of structures. So it completely follows the physics rules. If any physics rule is violated, so it will not let you continue with the game. Now we have electrons. This is another app. It will help us to learn about the charged particles. It is basically a charged particle simulator. So how charges behave and interact in different situations, particle and particle, how they interact, and you can simulate how the charges are stored on a lightning rod and how a cathode ray tube works. We can construct a cathode ray tube using this app, and you can play around with that. Okay, and then most of the hard to illustrate concepts have been explained in a very simple manner. So experiment that you can do in this app is nearly 10 virtual experiments are allowed, like attractive and repulsive forces have been explained in a illustrative manner. A charged cylinder, how charges are stored on a charged cylinder, and whenever another charge comes near to that, how the charges will relocate themselves on the surface of a charged cylinder, like a charged block of metal, redistribution of charge, how it happens on different objects, and a probe for detecting electric field, a capacitor and its electric field. All these you can construct, and you can see that how charges are behaving in these kind of situations. So it's a very good app, you can say, but it, one the drawback is it is a paid app. It looks like this. You can see two metal balls are taken here, and if you add some charges, there is an option for adding number of charges also. If you increase the number of charges, the distribution will appear how it looks, and if you bring another charge, opposite charge or like charge close to each other, so then how the charges are behaving from one another, whether it is attractive, whether it is repulsive, all those can be visualized in this app. Another one is Bobo Explores Light. So it is an app for understanding the light, optic principles or light principles. So Bobo is actually a comic robot, and that will take the users to different places. You can play around, and you can see everywhere the physics concepts are explained there, how light is undergoing reflection, refraction, how light enters into your eyes, how we can see. All those simple concepts can be explained in a very funny manner actually. So I will just show one small clipping here. I think it is not playing due to some app called Gravity Lab. It is meant for understanding the gravitational principles, how gravitational forces are working between different objects. So all those things can be visualized and understood in this Gravity Lab app. And we can also understand Kepler 3 laws, first two of the Kepler 3 laws in planetary motion. And it allows us to create our own universe, how universe can be constructed. So you can simulate, and you can understand the collision between the massive bodies, and you can verify the conservation laws of momentum and energy. All those things can be played around using this app. And let me show some.
Welcome to gravitational testing facility and observations. It looks like you got your hands onto those fancy new controllers. So let's put them to some good use.
Yeah.
other chimpanzees got here way faster.
So it is a paid app, and it requires some hardware also for seeing this virtual reality concepts. So next one is the Particle Zoo app. It is also, it's actually a free app available, and it will explain the behavior of fundamental particles. So it is not the zoo of animals, it is a zoo of particles. So how particles behave themselves, how many types of fundamental particles are there, what are their characteristics, what are their structures, from nucleons, quarks, leptons, and all that good stuff is available. And it will help students to understand the concepts of these particles much better. So let me show some thinking on this.
Different types of subatomic particles have been discovered in high energy accelerators around the world over the last century. At first, it seems like there might be too many to organize. But thanks to important work by physicists in the mid-century, we have some very valuable organizing principles we can work with. This simulation is presented like a zoo map. You might remember using these maps when you went to the zoo as a kid. There are three major areas of our zoo: the Lepton Safari, the Boson Pond, and the Hadron Forest. Now, these are just whimsical categories. Don't attach too much meaning to the safari imagery or the forest imagery. The lower left, and we can click on this when we're done to get back to the main map, which are electrons, muons, and tau particles. And the much lighter, light, fluffy matter is responsible for the strong nuclear force. It is what binds quarks together to make protons called baryons. Examples of baryons include the proton and neutron. We think of each quark as carrying in blue. When you combine all three of these, smaller particles. This gives you a sense of the types of decay paths these particles will follow.
So it is a very good app for understanding.
So play around and enjoy your time in the subatomic particles.
So let us move on to the next one, a Vernier Video Physics. Vernier Video Physics is an app for understanding the physics behind the moving objects. Just like when a ball is thrown, what kind of path a ball is following. A trajectory of the ball movement can be traced out, and what equation of physics is followed by that ball movement. All those things can be analyzed: with what velocity ball is moving, what is the acceleration, deceleration, where it will end up after losing its energy. All those things can be understood very well with Vernier Video Physics. And we have two apps here. One is Vernier Video Physics, and the same job is also done by another app called Tracker. It is also a free video analysis software. It is built on an open source physics code. And you can see some, let me try showing you through a video. Oh, it's not coming, it seems. Okay, no problem. So it will look somewhat like this. If you allow a an object to move like this, so you can assign a tracker to the object movement. So it will trace it in the form of dots and how the particle is moving. So it's actually movement of back and forth. You can see its path is traced in the form of a wave. So it is going back up and down like that. So it is moving back and forth like that. We can analyze the movement of the particle, and from that analysis we can understand the physics behind that movement of that object. So these kind of apps have been used by many people working in sports area also, like in cricket or football. When a ball moves from center of the ground to the edge, what trajectory it has followed, what is the distance it has covered, what was the velocity of the ball with which it went up and went down. So all those calculations, what they show while watching the cricket match. So all these things are done by tools like Tracker. So now let us see what are the resources available for teaching laboratory online. So we already know that physics is nothing but understanding universal laws of nature. It explains from how nature around us works to working of universe. Hence, nature itself is an excellent laboratory to understand physics behind every event of nature. Many teachers have excelled in teaching physics using simple materials available around us. Our cell phones have several sensors to measure magnetic fields. It works as a magnetometer. We can measure what is the magnetic field around us, nearby. If you have any magnetic fields, it can detect. Gravity sensor is there in your mobiles, so it can estimate what is the gravity force acting at that point. Light proximity sensor is there. So all that kind of tools can be used for doing some experiments also. And many teachers have learned these kind of skills, and they uploaded on YouTube or something, some sources like that. We can search over there. And I have some tools here, XSPICE. So it is a hardware, a small instrument that has been designed and popularized by IUAC, that is Inter University Accelerator Center, that is in the campus of Delhi University, and it's a UGC autonomous body, and it will facilitate the experimental instrument, whatever physics and other science area researchers require. So they provide facilities over there. People can go there and do experiments, and they can do research there. And as a product, they have developed this XSPICE to popularize the simple way of doing physics experiment. So it is called XSPICE, that instrument name. Earlier it was called as XSPICE Junior. Now a revised and advanced version is available, that's called XSPICE 17. And the features of this hardware is, it has got most of the laboratory requirements what we use in physics laboratory, like oscilloscope. It has got a 4-channel oscilloscope, but the oscilloscope what we are using in our laboratory is either single channel or dual channel, but it has got a 4-channel oscilloscope. And a sine or triangular wave generator is there. A function generator is already inbuilt there. It will operate from 5 hertz to 5 kilowatts. And the beauty of this instrument is the frequency is highly precise. Programmable voltage sources is there, so you can program it. So it will increase the voltage from 0 to plus or minus 5 volt in multiples of small steps. Frequency counter and time measurements can be done, and standard sensors it can detect. Most of the standard sensors what we had, like temperature sensor, magnetic field sensor, all those things it will recognize. It's a 12-bit analog resolution equipment, and it also includes a free software, XSPICE software, that you can install it on your computer, and you connect this hardware to the computer and you can use it. And we have the app in the Android version also, in Linux version also, Debian version also. So you can install them on your mobile phones also. Mobile phone can be used as your oscilloscope. The device will look like this. It is XSPICE 17. This is the source section. This is the measurement section. This part is measurement, and this is source section. It contains a function generator, DC voltage source, AC voltage source, all that kind of stuff are available here. And this is the measurement section. It can measure voltages, temperatures, all those things can be done here. And they have provided a list of experiments here. More than 50 experiments are available, already designed. So most of the physics laboratory experiments have been already converted into XSPICE 17. And one more thing is, they conduct training also, how to use this equipment and how to conduct experiment in order to educate teachers around India. So they conduct training courses of 1 week duration, both at their center, like that is Inter University Accelerator Center, New Delhi, and also in many of the parts of India. So only if you go into their website, there they announce it, you can register there, and you can go to the venue and you can learn it, and you can have hands-on experience in learning how to do experiments using XSPICE. And most of the physics experiments you can do using XSPICE equipment. So they provide TEA and DEA, so at zero cost we can learn this instrument. And another app that I am going to show is Stellarium. So this is actually an app that you can download either on your computer or mobile. Both versions are available. And those who are more curious about observing the sky, understanding the different stars, what are their names, what are their positions, where are those planets of our solar system, when solar eclipse is going to happen, when a lunar eclipse is going to happen. All those informations can be understood in a better manner using this app. It can tell you what is the location, what is your location. You can fix your location, and if you just focus your camera towards a particular star, so it will tell you what is the name of that particular star. Okay. And also, if you don't know how to look for a particular star, so like Polaris, if you want to see where the Polaris is in the sky, if you look at the sky, you will see millions of stars. Which one is Polaris, we don't know. So if you give input as search Polaris, so it will guide you. So it will ask you to rotate your mobile camera in a different direction. If you just follow the instructions, it will simply take you to that particular star, say Polaris. Like that, it is a very useful app to understand the stars as well as our solar system. And those who are have a hobby of watching sky, they have this kind of tools already. And as an equivalent to Stellarium, we have another app that is from the Google again, that's called Google Sky Map. Google Sky Map also works in the same fashion, but as an user, Google Sky Map is much easier than Stellarium. Stellarium is for quite advanced users, whereas Google Sky Map is for general users, which do not bother about the most of the advanced concepts. So it is a general user app, so you can use Google Sky Map. Its interface is quite easy, and the searching stars and all is very quite easy here. So these are the, it looks somewhat like this Stellarium app.
Hey everyone, this is John Reed here, author of 50 Things to See with a Small Telescope, and this is a crash course in the program Stellarium. So the first thing you want to do if you don't have Stellarium yet is download it from the internet. It's free at www.stellarium.org. You just choose your operating system and it will take you to the appropriate download site. Then you choose it from your night sky. So if you open it at night, it will show night. If you open it during the day, it will show the day, very live. Anyway, first thing you want to do is check your settings. So you want to make, the next thing you want to do is a week from now or a couple hours from now of the stars you want to see. The search window is very important. The thing about the search, it is very spelling sensitive. So if you're looking for the Andromeda Galaxy and you spell galaxy wrong, it will not find it. Kind of annoying, but it works once you know what you're doing. And some advanced options that you really don't need to go into this ever, unless you're doing some advanced stuff like comet hunting, and if you're looking to find stuff based on a coordinate system, not very common in this day of age because we have software to help us find stuff. Here you have the ground. I usually would recommend leaving east instead of west. Your second option is to wait for your option, because if you're looking at how something moves throughout time.
So I think these are some of the things what I wanted to share. And it is not the only things what we can look for online. There are plenty of tools available for online teaching, both for general subject teachers as well as physics teachers. Only thing is, we have to explore them and we have to use them in an appropriate manner, and then only I hope we can come out of this kind of situations and we can adapt ourselves for online teaching. And if you have any suggestions and comments, please leave in the comment section. Thank you for listening.
Good morning, dear friends and participants. Today, I am going to speak on online education challenges and possibilities. As all of you know, in the month of March, there was an extraordinary situation. The whole world was locked down, and immediately academic institutions have gone for alternative way of teaching and learning. They thought that online education was the way out. So online teaching using various internet options are available today, and academic institutions have gone for it. But this online mode of education has triggered a tremendous debate in academic circles as well as in social media. And today I am going to share my views on the possibilities and challenges of this online education. Before I enter the subject, let me present before you two diametrically opposite views on online education. Some of the people say that online education is inevitable now. When people are not able to contact each other, when people are not able to reach out to each other, how to reach out is the question. And the answer is that technology is the only way. And by technology, I mean online e-learning. They say that technology is the present as well as the future. Whether there is lockdown or no lockdown, technology is going to take over, and therefore it has become inevitable. This is one possibility. This is one of the arguments present before us by the experts. But some of them have questioned this view. Their argument is that in a country like India, a poor or underdeveloped country like India, it's not possible to reach out to people. If you are not able to reach out to people, the very purpose of online education is defeated. Therefore, it is very difficult to treat online education as a kind of a substitute. So, before I enter, as I said, these are the two diametrically opposite point of views. One is that online education is the present and the future, and the other is that it is not possible in a country like India. So let me look at some of the challenges, the problems of online education. The first thing that comes to our mind is that there are technical difficulties. People in rural area or in many parts of India do not afford smartphones. They don't have the technology to reach out. And therefore, if you are going for online education, if there is a problem of technical reachability, the very purpose of online education is defeated. And it leads to exclusion of large number of students. Higher education cannot exclude people. It has to include people. And therefore, one of the difficulties of online education is that reachability, technical difficulties leading to exclusion of many people. So this problem has to be addressed first. If we are not able to address this problem, then we are entering into a very dangerous kind of a debate. And this question is not the question of a theory. It is a question which is related to socio-economic condition of people in India. And remember, in the month of March, we locked down. And even today, the situation is continuing, and people are not able to attend classes. We are not able to initiate dialogue with students, etc., etc. There are already reports of students going to labor sector, and once they enter this labor sector, it's very difficult to bring them back. And therefore, the first question that we need to address is this kind of a theoretical, sociological question, a larger question. And therefore, the question is that if online education be made successful, it has to be inclusive rather than exclusive. It has to include people. It has to reach out to people. So one has to address this question. The next one is the problem of concentration. Theoretically speaking, even if we reach out to students through different internet options, the question of concentration remains there. What is a classroom? A classroom is not simply, you know, a pool of chairs and benches. It is a room which includes people. It's a room where a unique kind of atmosphere is created. It's a room where interaction takes place. It's a classroom where sharing of ideas take place. But in online education, this kind of sharing might be missing. If this debate is missing in online education, then one has to overcome it. The next question that we need to address is related to infrastructural facilities in undergraduate courses. We will have to remember that there is a difference between technical institutions and academic institutions where BA, BCom, BSc is being taught. At present, the infrastructural facilities are not very good. This is one other problem. And the other problem is that teachers are used to traditional classroom teaching rather than online virtual teaching. And therefore, there is also a problem of training of teaching faculty. Without training of teaching faculty, if online education is going for all out reaching thing, then it's very problematic. Online teaching demands different skills. It demands different sets of skills. There must be proper planning. There must be preparation. There must be a kind of an interaction with the participants. And if this is lacking, then it also becomes problematic. And therefore, let me tell you that if at all online education is going to be successful, the infrastructural facilities at undergraduate courses must be addressed. It must be overcome. And the other, as I said just now, is that relating to the training of the teaching faculty. Most of them are not well equipped. And today, many institutions are claiming a lot of success of online classes. But is it true is the question. We will have to look at the data. We will have to look at the response of students. We will have to go for the feedback from students. And once this feedback is taken, then there can be improvement. And therefore, these are the two other areas where problems of teaching comes up. The other problem which is related to this is the availability of multiple sources of learning. Even before the lockdown, internet revolution was there, and therefore different sources, multiple sources were available for students. And now the government, the institutions and other participants have gone for different sources of videos available. If students are given the option of choosing, many of them might find it very difficult to choose which one to go, which one not to go is the question. And therefore, when there is a possibility of a choice, learner must be properly guided. Otherwise, the very existence of choice might become a problem. The other question which is related to online learning is related to methodology. At present, So many video lectures are being shared in social media. Now the question is, just promoting a video lecture method in internet, is it the objective of higher education? Is it enough? Does it mean that it's the effective way of learning? So when we speak about online education, we will have to look at this avoiding mechanical kind of lecture method even in online mode of learning. Therefore, a dynamic kind of education, a dynamic kind of learning, teaching is quite necessary. One has to address this problem as well. Just providing notes through WhatsApp, just providing information is not enough. And in fact, in the age of internet, this kind of information was already available. If we are going to repeat the same, the objective of online education is not going to be fulfilled. Now, let me address another very important theoretical question. That is, what is the objective of higher education? Is it just to provide information? Is it just to reach out to people? My take on this point is that one has to look at how to construct a very dynamic, sensitive, free-thinking, responsible individual. That is one of the important objectives of higher education. And the question now is that whether online learning and teaching is able to do that. So let me repeat what I said in the beginning, that the classroom is a unique kind of a place where learning takes place, a kind of participatory learning takes place. If it is made possible in online learning, then it is all right. If it is not, then it becomes very problematic. Therefore, before I continue, let me rephrase what I already said. When we speak about online education, there are number of questions which are need to be addressed. Whether we can reach out to people, whether dynamic kind of learning is possible, whether it is inclusive or exclusive, whether we look at socio-economic condition of learners, all these are the important challenges. How to overcome is the question. I am not an expert in this area, but experts can address this question. Without addressing such very important theoretical and practical questions, online education is very problematic. Therefore, we can say that online education is in its formative years. We are in the first step. We need to fine-tune it. We need to fine-tune online education, and we will have to make it all inclusive. Therefore, let me tell you that if online education excludes many poorer section of people, then the very concept becomes very problematic. And we will have to understand that most of us teach at undergraduate level. We take up classes for BA students, and there is a huge difference between technical courses as well as and undergraduate college education. And this disparity between technical institutions and undergraduate BA courses must be addressed. And let me tell you that all academic institutions are not homogeneous categories. There are differences, and therefore online education must address this disparity. So I am pointing out some of the difficulties or challenges of online learning. That doesn't mean that I am a traditionalist opposing technology. I know that technology is here, and it's going to be here for a very long time. And in this last part, let me talk about the possibilities. As you know, technology is always for innovation. As you know, technology is always for experimentation. And then, and therefore, if one uses technology effectively, there can always be experimentation as well as innovation. And this innovation and experimentation is one of the positives of online learning. Then there is the question of flexibility. People can be reached out. People, you can address people all over the world. Or students can learn from experts all over the world. It bypasses time and space, and therefore technology becomes a boon here. And the third one is relating to technological excellence. Excellence in the classroom can be matched through excellence in technology. You can listen, you can learn from great scholars worldwide. You can look at the experimentation and innovation carried out by the resource persons. And therefore, enough resources are available and people can use that. And the third one, as you can see, in a situation like the lockdown, when people are not able to meet each other, when people are not able to come together, and this technology-driven online learning provides an alternative method. And this alternative is quite important. And therefore, online learning cannot be dismissed as if it's a kind of a doomsday activity. One can always say that a fair balance between classroom education and e-learning is a better option. Thank you very much.